we already discussed till question number 13 of JEE Main 2020, January 9th, shift 2 question paper. So we can continue with the question number 14. We are waiting a very good question. A rod of length L has non-uniform linear mass density given by that we can write it as lambda, say with the depends upon x, by the equation a plus b x by L the whole square, where a and b are constants at 0 less than or equal to x less than or equal to L. The value of x for the center of mass of the rod is, so that is we need to find it. So suppose say our rod is like this one, but with a variable linear density, so there is no uniform density is there. So we can just assume one small element with a mass dm, with a width as dx at a separation x from this origin O, then by integration method, you know how to find the center of mass location is equal to integral x dm, that division by integral dm. So here that limits is given as from 0 to L. So in order to convert that dm in terms of x term, we can write the concept as a linear density for that small element as a dm by dx, that is equal to that is the mass per unit length equal to x square division by L square, and therefore the dm take the value equal to a plus b into x square by L square into dx. Then we can just substitute for dm by this equation, and we can write is equal to integral 0 to L of x into a plus b x square by L square into dx by integral 0 to L a plus b x square by L square into dx. So that is equal to, you can just multiply here, and we can write the independent terms together as integral 0 to L ax dx ax dx plus integral 0 to L b by L square b by L square x square dx, that division by integral 0 to L a dx plus integral 0 to L b x square by L square into dx. So that is equal to a into, you know the integral x, that is x square by 2 between the limit 0 to L plus b by L square into x cube, that division by 3 between the limit 0 to L, that division a into integral x form as x between the limit 0 to L plus b by L square into x cube division by so here once again, and here it is x cube, good, b x cube, so it become x raised to 4 by 4. So here b x cube division by 3 between the limit 0 to L. So if you just substitute the values, then we get the value as a by 2 into L square plus here b by 4 L square into L raised to 4, that division by A L plus B b by l square into l cube by 3. So l square cancel. And we can take l square by 2 in common. Then you get the value as a plus b by 2. The division by, we can take that l square cancel. So we can take l in common, a plus b by 3. So you get the value equal to, so you can just cross it. That is equal to 1 by 2 into 2a plus b, that division by 2 by 3a plus b by 3. So that is, we can write as equal to 2a plus b. So one is l is there, so l by 2. So 2a plus b. So that the 3 become on the numerator. So 3, that division by 3a plus b into 2 into 2 as 4 into l. So that is answer. 3 by 4. 3 by 4, 2a plus b by 3a plus b into l, and we can code the answer as 4. A good question. Good question. So keep in mind the speciality of this equation. For extended objects, we can use that concept to find the location of the center of mass. Number 15, a good question. There is a small source of light at some depth below the surface of water. There the refractive index that is given as 4 by 3. In a tank of large cross-sectional surface area, neglecting any reflection from the bottom and absorption by water, the percentage of light that emerges out of the surface is. So keep in mind, we have to use that critical angle concept. So from this source, the rays are moving in every direction. See, but and this ray is reflected back to it. So that is the concept we have to consider. And hence, see, this is the axis and is given us as the h height and r is the radius there. Good. So with respect to the normal, we can say, and if that is beta angle, and this is the beta angle, that is the critical angle there. So we can say that the sine beta, and that is equal to, and simply we can measure it as sine beta is 1 by the refractive index as 4 by 3. So that is equal to 3 by 4. And based on that, we can find the value of cos beta. And that is equal to root 7 by 4. And keep in mind, if the half cone angle is beta, then what is the area on the surface? That is here, the shaded area. Area made by it. We can just link it with the solid angle. So that area on that solid angle, hold together, that value is nothing but is equal to 2 pi the radius square into 1 minus cos beta. So that is a very important concept. So that is the area of light coming from this surface. But based on a point source is considered, you know, for our radius, the total area covered is nothing but equal to 4 pi r square. And hence, here we want to calculate what is the percentage of the light emerges out. So, with respect to this area, so that is nothing but equal to 2 pi r square into 1 minus cos beta. But the total area, that is nothing but equal to 4 pi r square, that much into 100%. So, that is the answer. So, that is equal to, you can cancel it as 1 by 2 into 1 minus the cos beta is root 7 by 4, that much into 100%. So you get the value equal to 4 minus root 7 division by 8 into 100%. And you get the value as roughly 17% as the answer. A good question. So keep in mind this concept. If the half solid angle is, cone angle is there, then how we can connect with the area subtended by the solid angle? So that is 2 pi r square into cos beta. The solid angle there is 2 pi into 1 minus cos beta. It is a good concept. Number 16. A uniformly thick wheel with moment of inertia I and radius capital R is free to rotate about its center of mass. That is M1 and this is M2. A massless string is wrapped over its rim and the two blocks of masses M1 and M2. It is given as M1 greater than M2 are attached to the ends of the string. The system is released from rest. The angular speed of the wheel when M1 descends by a distance h is. So at first we can assume that is a reference line. And suppose with respect to that one, the both the masses are at the same height. Then when it is released from rest, that M1 moves towards bottom through a distance, say, h. And that M2 is rises to the same distance. So that is h. We can treat that with respect to the reference line. This one gains a height of h. So h plus and it losses. And hence we can take as h minus. We can move the simple concept as using our conservation of mechanical energy. Before beginning the motion, we can say, we can say the kinetic energy initial plus the potential energy, it should be equal to, with respect to, is equal to the kinetic energy final plus the potential energy final. And keep in mind one thing, say this is said to be a reference line. The potential energy because of the gravitation, with respect to that reference line is common for the two cases. So we can avoid that potential energy contribution in the two cases because of their equal contribution. So before the kinetic energy, we can say both the values are zero there. It should be equal to. We emit the gravitational contribution on the two cases. Then what is the kinetic energy for? There are three movements are here. For the M1, if it is with the velocity V, then we can say that, say, the half M2 into as V square plus, and for M2, M1, we can write as half M1 V square plus. If omega is the angular velocity for the disk, we can say that as half I into omega square plus. The potential energy contribution for the three cases we can write as M1GH and minus M2GH. So that is a very important concept. And we are considering that same reference line and hence the gravitational potential energy is because of that height is neglected there. And here we can take this one to this side. We can write as M2 minus M1 into GH, that should get the value equal to, we can substitute it for V as V is equal to R omega, the V is equal to R omega, so and hence we can write as half M2 into as omega R square plus as half M1 into omega R square plus half I omega square. So that is equal to, we can take as a half into M2 plus M1 into R square plus I into omega square. So we need to find what is omega square. You can just take it and get the value as 2 into m2 minus m1 into dh division by m1 plus m2 into r square plus I. So that is the value of omega square. If we just take, then you get the answer. So equal to 2 into m2 minus m1 gh by m1 plus m2 plus r square into I. So there is a small mistake with the interpretation. So there is a, yes, so there is a, the potential energy gained by it, it should be plus and it should be negative. So that is the misconcept there. So then it becomes a m2 and this become m1 and we get the value as a m1 minus m2. Good, 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 good. So with respect to this one, that mass, that is m2, gains energy and this one losses on. So it becomes good, good, very good concept there. Okay, that is m1 minus m2. So we get the answer as 3 as the answer. A good question. Number 17. A wire length L and a mass per unit length 6 into 10 raised to minus 3 is put under tension of 540 Newton. The two consecutive frequencies that it resonates at are 420 Hertz and 490 Hertz. Then the length in meters is, so we have to find it. So we know for a stretched string, we know every harmonics are present. So if it is taken as nth harmonics, we can written as n into V by 2L, that take the value as 420 Hertz. The next harmonic is, you know, it is n plus 1, that into V by 2L, so that is given as 490 Hertz. So just dividing, you get the value as n by n plus 1, take the value equal to 42 by 49. So n into 49, take the value as n into 42 plus 42. So you just take this one to this side as a 7n, take the value as a 42. So n take the value as a 6. So you can substitute the value here. Then we know the value for velocity as a root tension by the linear density. Then we can write the expression for L is equal to n into V as a root T by mu by 2 into as a 420. That is equal to 6 into root of as a 540 the tension by that mass per unit length by the value as a 6 into 10 raised to minus 3 that division by 2 into 420. By solving you get the value as 2.14. so 2 as the answer. Number 18. A good question. A plane electromagnetic wave that is propagating along the direction I plus j root 2. So that propagation vector direction, so that is given as is equal to k into I plus j by root 2. And its polarization is the direction k cap. So the electric field vectors are along the direction of k cap. The correct form of the magnetic field would be, so how we can think that one? So it is given the k direction and the electric field direction, it is also given. So that is equal to k cap. So this is the propagation constant, keep in mind, k. So how we can represent? We know the one concept. The direction of propagation is nothing but equal to the E cross B. So that is a very important concept. So we don't know what is the direction for B. We know the direction of propagation. It is already given as I plus j by root 2. But it should be, we get from the direction of E cross B. So we don't know it. So, but we can, brainly we can collect by using the determinant concept by just taking the direction of the valley. So that division by, so the electric field direction is simply, that is along the direction of K, good. Along the direction of K, so I am written as 1. And that magnetic field direction, we don't know. We can take its value as x, y, z, say x, y, z. So we needed to find it. So we get the value. So that value as I into, so the value is minus y, minus j into, so minus x, plus k into 0. So that is equal to minus yi plus xj. So what is the value for I? So here, this is the direction for and here we can say xi plus yj, that is the direction for the magnetic field. But we don't know what is the value of x and y. But from this equation, you know that y take the value as minus 1 by root 2. And x take the value as 1 by root 2. So b take the value as 1 by root 2 I minus 1 by root 2 j. So that is a very important concept. So we know the concept for the magnetic field direction. And also keep in mind, and here the electromagnetic wave is propagating in the value of I plus j by root 2 in the sense. So if it moves in I direction, we have to express it as in minus concept. So that is a very important concept. So omega t minus k into I plus j by root 2. So it may be, and here we need to give the direction for B. So B0, I minus j by root 2 cos omega t minus k into s. So the 18th one. So we get the answer as 3. So carefully, please go through it. It is a good aspect. Number 19. Two steel wires having the same length are suspended from a ceiling under the same load. If the ratio of their energy stored per unit volume is 1:4, then the ratio of their diameters is. How we can find it? So we can just draw one figure. Two steel wires with different diameters got the same length. Yes. So again the weight as mg. So whatever may be the case, and here it is given the ratio of the energy stored as U1 by U to take the value as 1/4. And keep in mind here the question is the find the ratio of their diameters. You know that potential energy take the value is nothing but equal to half into the stress into strain. So that is nothing but the energy per unit volume. But we can write as is equal to the stress into the strain can be written as the stress division by y. So that is equal to half into that stress square, that division by y. So that is the potential energy. But we know the stress is the force by area. So the force square division by a square y. But it is given the same material. So y are same for both the cases. And the load given are same. That means the potential energy is proportional to that area square in the sense inversely proportional to fourth power of its diameters. So that is a very important concept. So we know that area is proportional to r square proportional to d raised to. So d square. So a square proportional to d raised to 4. So we can just take the ratio as 1 by u1 by u2 is equal to d2 by d1 raised to 4. So our aim is to find what is d2 by d1 is equal to root u1 by u2. U1 by u2 is given as 1 by 4. So that is equal to 1 by 2. But here, keep in mind, d2 by d1 raised to 4, that is 1 by 4th power. So that is a very important concept. So we can say that 1 by 4 raised to 1 by 2 raised to 1 by 2. So 1 by 2 raised to 1 by 2. So that is equal to 1 by root 2. Our aim is to find what is the ratio of that diameters, d1 by d2. So that is equal to root 2 by, so that is a very important concept, root 2 by 1. So we can take the answer as the fourth choice, root 2 is to 1. A good question. So, but keep in mind, this is the energy stored per unit volume. If the question is with the energy, then we have to take as a half into load into extension. So good concept. Number 20, a good collection of concepts. A small spherical droplet of density D is floating exactly half immersed in a liquid of density rho and surface tension T. The radius of the droplet is, take the surface tension, applies an upward force on the droplet. So we can just draw the figure like this one. In addition to the floating condition, there an additional, so a drop is there with a half immersed. There the surface tension is acting vertically. What are the forces acting there? The weight mg that is acting vertically downward. And the upthrust is acting vertically upward. In addition to that, the force due to the surface tension is acting vertically. So, and hence, we can say, in order to balance them, the weight mg that should be balanced with the upthrust with the force of tension, surface tension. But keep in mind, if you just look the top view, the sphere, there the surface tension that is acting vertically upward like this one. So that is a very important concept. So how we can find that? The surface tension is nothing but equal to force per the unit length. So that is nothing but equal to 2 pi r. So the force due to the surface tension is that surface tension into 2 pi r. So suppose V is the volume. We can code that M is nothing but equal to volume into, here it is given as the density as D into G. So that is equal to the upthrust here, the half immersion into the density of the liquid as rho into G plus that is force due to the surface tension as T into 2 pi r. We can take this one to the left hand side. We can take the value V into, that is D minus rho by 2 into G. So that should be equal to T into 2 pi r. We can substitute it for volume. So volume is what? It is 4 by 3 pi r cube into, so you just cross it, 2D minus rho, that division by 2 into G, that is equal to T into 2 pi r. So here 2 cancel, that 2 pi cancel. So 1 r cancel. So we can easily write that for r square is equal to 3 into t division by 2d minus rho, 2d minus rho into g. So you get the equation for r is equal to root of 3t, that division by 2d minus rho, that much into g. So that is a good concept. So we get the answer as 1. So in addition to the normal floating condition, we have to add the contribution due to the surface tension with a vertically upward direction. Number 21, a simple but good question. We are waiting 5 numerical type questions, but it's a standard is compared to other questions. It becomes so easy. The circuit shown below is working as a 8 volt DC regulated voltage source. When 12 voltage is used as input, the power dissipated in millivolt is. So keep in mind here the 12 volt, the 8 volt is across this one, and the rest, the 4 volt is across this one. So we can find easily the current flowing through that. The current flowing through it is nothing but is equal to the potential there, the 4 division by the total resistance as 200 plus 200. So that is equal to 4 by as 400. So that is equal to 10 rise to minus 2 ampere. So that is the current flowing through that circuit. But our aim is to find what is the power loss through each diode. That is our question. If I is the current flowing through here, you know, out of 8 volt, 4 volt for each diodes. So the power loss is nothing but the power potential across the diode into the current across the diode is equal to the potential as 4 into the current as 10 rise to minus 2. So that is equal to, if you just multiply 110 and divide, you become 40 into 10 rise to minus 3. So that is equal to 40 milliwatt. So the answer become 40. We have it expressed in milliwatt. So it is a simple question. Number 22. In Young's double slit experiment, 15 fringes are observed on a small portion of the screen when light wavelength 500 nanometer is used. 10 fringes are observed on the same section of the screen when another light source of lambda is used. Then the value of lambda is in nanometer. So say suppose this is the two slits are used. This is the screen, and say this is the location of the center maxima. So suppose this is the location under consideration. So here it is say N1 fringes are there. So that location can be easily written as N1 B1. But in the it is given, it is filled with the N2 beta 2 in the second case. But the fringe width beta is nothing but equal to lambda capital D by small d. For the first case, it is given that N1 as 15 with a lambda 1, say lambda 1, as a lambda 1 into capital D by small d, it should be equal to, in the second case, the 10 fringes into lambda 2 into, again, the same setup. So they will cancel. And our aim is to find what is the lambda. So lambda, take the value as 15 lambda 1 by 10. So that is equal to 3 by 2 times of 500 nanometer. Then we get the value as 750 nanometer. And keep in mind, we have to answer in 750. So that is answer. Number 23. In a meter bridge experiment, S is a standard resistance, R is a resistance wire. It is found that the balance length is L equal to 25 centimeter. If R is replaced by a wire of, so we can say that R is a rho into L by area. It is replaced with another one with R dash, got the half the length, we can say that L by 2, and half the diameter, that means area become pi d square. So, and we can say that A by 4. So that is equal to 2 into R. Then the balance length is L dash. We have to find the value of L dash. For the first case, we can simply using the Wheatstone principle, we can say that R by S should equal to L by 100 minus L. As P by Q is equal to R by S. But for the second case that R is replaced with R dash, but it is, we found it to be 2R. So 2R by S, that should be equal to L dash by 100 minus L. So that is a condition given. So you can just divide the two relations, then you get the value as 1 by 2 is equal to as L by 100 minus L and L dash by 100 minus L dash. So you just crossing it. So you get the value as 100 L dash 100 L dash minus L L dash is equal to 2 into 100, 200 L minus 2 L L dash. But we know that L is 25. So 100 L dash minus 25 L dash is equal to 200 into 25. It becomes as a 5000 minus as a 50 L dash. So here 75 L dash minus 50. So it become 75 L dash is equal to 5000 minus 50 L dash. 75 plus 50 as 125 L dash. That value become 5000. So L dash should take the value as 5000 division by 125. So that is equal to as 40 centimeter, a good concept. So we have to use the Wheatstone bridge principle. Number 24. Starting at a temperature 300 Kelvin, one mole of an ideal diatomic gas with gamma equal to 1.4 is first compressed adiabatically from volume V1 to V2. It is then allowed to expand isobarically to volume 2V2. So that means V1 by 8. 2V2 become V1 by 8. If all the processes are at quasi static, then the final temperature of the gas is. So at first, to avoid the confusion, so we can just draw the curve that pressure volume. The first process, the decreasing its volume, but adiabatically, we can say the graph is like this one, then isobarically. So this is A, so that is taken as V1. In the second case, that volume is become V1 by 16, and the case then is becomes V by 8. So that is A, B into C. So the first case, it is adiabatic process from A to B. So for that, we know the PV raised to gamma is a constant. In order to link with the temperature, we know TV raised to gamma minus 1 is a constant. So by using that concept for the two cases, we can write TA, VA raised to gamma minus 1 equal to TB, VB raised to gamma minus 1. So all the data are given here. So our attempt is to find what is the temperature at the point B here. So TB is equal to TA, the given term, into VA by VB, the whole raised to gamma minus 1. So that is equal to TA into, and that is equal to, it is given the volume in the second case is the initial volume by 16, that much into gamma. The gamma is what? 1.4 minus 1. So you get the value equal to 300 into 16 raised to 0.1. So that is the concept till B. Then it expand isobarically. Isobarically, P is a constant. So we can say the volume is proportional to the temperature by using the concept as P is equal to nRT. So by using that, we can write VB at the point by the temperature at the point is equal to at the point C, we can say as VC by TC. So our aim is to temperature at the end. So TC equal to TB into VC by VB. It is given that VC is VB by 2. So 2V, double of V2. So 2VB. So 2 times the temperature at the point B. That is equal to 2 into 300 into 16 rise to 0.04. On solving, you get the value as 1818 km. So that is a good question. The numerical concept is very, very important. number the last question. A good question coming from electrostatic. It is given an electric field by the value as E is equal to 4xi minus y square plus 1 into j passes through the box shown in the figure. The flux of the electric field through the surfaces A, B, C, D and BCGF are marked as phi 1 and phi 2 respectively. The difference between the value of phi 1. So the phi 1 simply the integral E dot dA. But keep in mind here the speciality. The electric field is on the XY line. The electric field is like this one. But here the area vector for ABCD is in the upward direction. So both fix an angle of 90. We can say the value as 0. But how we can think for the flux through BCEF? So keep in mind here that electric field got the direction like this one. The area vector is along that one. And simply we can say the flux 2 is nothing but equal to E dot A. So that is a very important concept. So that is equal to the electric field is given as 4xi minus y square plus 1 into j cap dot the area of this one. So this height is 2 and this one as 3. So this this gap, this is 2 and this is as 2 and the area vector, that is a very important concept. It is acting along this one. So that is a very important one. So we need to find this is the this height. So this height is nothing but the z component 2. And we need to find this one. So this one is nothing but this concept, that is 2. So 2 into 2. So 2 into 2 as 4. But the area vector is along i. So you just multiply. The dot product only existing the similar component. So 4xi. So 4x into 4. So 16x. So the x component is here. It is the value as 3. So 16 into 3. So you get the value as 40i. But our aim is to find what is phi 1 minus phi 2. That is equal to 0 minus 40i. So you get the answer as 40i Newton meter square by Coulomb. So we get the answer as. So keep in mind for J main. And out of 25, we can wait 11 to 12 questions so easily. But other questions are conceptual questions. So if you try to do maximum MCQs, then you can get a maximum score. So that is a concept. Okay, we can wait for the further videos.